All right, let's dive in. Today, we're heading over to Italy to explore the Olona River. And looking at these sources, one thing really jumps out at me. It's almost a paradox. How can something like a river, something so physically present, become invisible to the people living around it?
It really is fascinating, isn't it? I think the Olona story is a powerful example of how a river can be so deeply intertwined with the society, even essential to it, but then as times change, it kind of fades into the background.
Yeah, for sure. What strikes me is looking at what you've said, this wasn't just some stream, you know? The Olona was a powerhouse, the lifeblood of industry for a long time.
Absolutely. We're talking pre-electricity, right?
Yeah.
So the sound of rushing water, it wasn't just, a nice background noise. It was the engine of progress, this river-powered mills, factories.
We're talking like what? Textile production, things like that. What else was going on along the
Boy,
Olonas?
textile mills for sure, paper mills even. Get this, an explosives factory, according to this Mizoki source.
Wait, hold on. An explosives factory. Okay, now you have to tell me more about that.
Yeah.
What were they making? Fireworks? Or something a little more, shall we say, intense?
Well, to be honest, the source is a little vague on the specifics, but it definitely adds a whole other layer to this river's past, right?
That's an understatement. I wouldn't have pictured an explosives factory. So it was a hub of industry, but it wasn't just factories, though, was it? Because I'm seeing stuff here about agriculture, too.
Right, exactly. I mean, it makes sense when you think about it. Water is life, after all. The Olona was absolutely crucial for irrigation. And this Villa Custode dell'Acqua source that you sent, it talks about this incredible system they had called Marsite.
Okay, Marcy, tell me more. That sounds new to me.
So imagine this. They're creating these meadows, constantly irrigated meadows, to grow fodder for their animals. And it's all thanks to carefully managing and channeling the Olona's flow. Pretty ingenious, especially back then.
That's really impressive, especially for the time period. But, and maybe I'm jumping the gun here, but when you have something as essential as water and everyone needs it, doesn't that often lead to some, shall we say, disagreements over who gets to use it?
You're spot on. Where there's a vital resource, there's often conflict. And the Villa Custode source actually talks about this. Frequent disputes between those mill owners we talked about and the farmers who needed water for their crops.
I can imagine everyone needing that precious water. So who usually won those disputes?
Well, the Villa Custode source mentions that more often than not, the mill owners had priority.
Really? Interesting. Why would the mill owners get priority over the people growing food?
It kind of gets to the heart of power dynamics back then. They held a lot of sway because they controlled a major part of the economy. Whoever controlled the flow of the Olona, in a lot of ways, controlled the region.
Power dynamics. Yeah. It makes you wonder how that kind of power, that control over such an essential resource, shaped the relationship people had with the river. And honestly, it also makes me wonder, did anyone back then see where things might be heading? Because I have a feeling, based on the sources you sent over, that it might not be pretty.
Yeah, I'm getting a bad feeling about this too. And I think, based on these sources, my hunch is right. Things took a turn for the worse. For the Olona, I mean.
Yeah, you're not wrong. Sadly, it's a classic case, really. The same river that powered all that progress, it also became the dumping ground for everything that came with it.
We're talking like, what? Sewage? Factory runoff? What kind of stuff ended up in the Olona?
You name it, untreated waste, chemicals, dyes. It all went straight into the river. It's kind of giving toxic waste dump, not exactly, pristine waterway. One of the sources, the Olona and Fiume film, actually mentions the river changing colors. I mean, that's kind of horrifying.
It's a powerful image, and unfortunately, not all that uncommon even today. Back then, environmental regulations, they were practically non-existent in many parts of the world.
So it's basically a free-for-all, and the Olona paid the price. But, and I think this goes without saying, but it wasn't just the river itself that was affected, right? Reading through these sources, it seems like people were suffering too.
Exactly. What happens to the environment ultimately affects all of us. And the human cost of the Olona's pollution, well, it's heartbreaking. There are accounts here of people getting sick, children getting blackened feet just from playing in the water.
Wow, that's just, it's awful. It really makes you think, doesn't it? Like, what would those generations think of how we're treating the environment today? Have we actually learned from those mistakes or?
It's a question worth asking ourselves, for sure. I mean, every generation faces its own environmental challenges, right? The important thing is that we learn from the past, both the mistakes and the successes.
And speaking of successes, the Olona story, thankfully, it doesn't end on a completely bleak note. Tell me there's some good news here. Did things ever start to turn around?
They did. Not overnight, of course. This wasn't a quick fix. But the Olona story does offer a glimmer of hope. Things started to change for the better, really, with the introduction of wastewater treatment plants in the 1980s.
Okay, that makes sense. That's a huge step in the right direction.
Yeah.
But we're still talking about decades of accumulated pollution, right? So I imagine cleaning that up wasn't as simple as just, you know, flipping a switch.
Oh, absolutely not. It was a long, complex process. The Olona on Fiume film does a good job of showing that, you know, that this shift, it was significant, don't get me wrong, but it didn't erase the damage overnight. Remediating that kind of impact, well, it takes time, it takes resources, and it definitely takes sustained effort. And even then.
So it's a journey, not a sprint kind mm-hmm. of thing, which makes me wonder, where does the Olona stand today? Has it bounced back?
Well, the good news is we are seeing signs of recovery. There's this source, the Rooting Spritz Palimpsest EU Milano, and it talks about the return of insects, fish, even birds to the area.
That's fantastic news. Nature's pretty amazing that way, isn't it? So resilient. But I feel like there's a but coming.
Ha! You know me too well. Yes, there is a bit of a but. The same source that describes that ecological rebound, it also calls the Olona an unstable ecological system.
Unstable. So even with all the progress, it's still a bit precarious. What does that even mean in this context?
Basically, it means the Olona's restored ecosystem. It's still heavily reliant on those wastewater treatment plants we talked about. If something were to happen to disrupt that delicate balance, it could send the river back into decline.
Ah, I see. So even with all the progress, it's not exactly a happily ever after situation. More like, stay tuned. What happens next is really up to us, isn't it?
Exactly. The Olona's future, it depends on so many factors. Continuous monitoring, adaptive management, and most importantly, collaboration.
Collaboration. That makes me think of that Contratto di Fiume Olona source you included in the stack. It's all about this really interesting collaborative approach to managing the river, bringing together everyone who has a stake in it.
It really is fascinating. You've got government agencies, local communities, NGOs,
right,
all coming together, acknowledging that they have a shared responsibility for the Olona's future.
It sounds promising, but I have to admit, looking at some of the other sources, I'm also seeing some pretty daunting challenges laid out. Droughts, for one, and invasive species, making sure everyone has fair access to water. It sounds like a constant balancing act, keeping all those plates spinning at once.
You hit the nail on the head, it's a balancing act for sure. And it's interesting because this is where that whole invisible river idea, it kind of resurfaces, but in a new way.
What do you mean? How so?
Well, the Rooting Spritz Palimpsest EU Milano source, it suggests that even with all the progress that's been made, a lot of locals, they still see the Olona through the lens of its past. Like they've disconnected from it emotionally, even if the water quality is better now.
Wow. So it's almost like even though the river is physically present, the damage that was done, it kind of created this psychological distance, this disconnect. It's like that saying, you can't unring a bell. You know,
it's true. And it really highlights how complex river restoration really is. It's not just about the water quality or bringing back the wildlife. We also have to think about the human element, the community's relationship with the river. We have to find a way to rebuild that connection to help people rediscover the Olona, appreciate its value. Because a river without people who care for it, well, it's always going to be vulnerable.
I think that's a really important point. It's not enough to just, you know, clean up the mess we've made. We have to actively rebuild those connections, foster a sense of stewardship, right? But how do you do that? How do you change a perception that's been ingrained over generations?
That's the million-dollar question, isn't it? It takes more than just, you know, putting up a few signs or stocking the river with fish. It needs a real fundamental shift in how people see the river, how they relate to it.
So almost like giving it a new identity.
Exactly. Not about erasing the past. Of course, that's part of the story, too. It's more about weaving it all together, you know? The industrial past, the pollution, the recovery, the people. Creating a more complete and honestly more hopeful narrative.
I like that. A more complete narrative. And it makes me think about something I saw in one of these sources, the RLAOV1, about a proposed museum of water. Dedicated to the Olona, of course. I mean, what do you think about that? Could something like that work, help rewrite the story of the Olona?
I think that's an absolutely brilliant idea. What better way to get people engaged than to create a space where they can really dive into the river's history?
Right. Imagine, like, exhibits about those incredible irrigation systems we talked about, the impact of industrialization, the community-driven efforts to bring the Olona back to life, and maybe even, you know, a whole section dedicated to the volunteers, those folks who've given so much to help this river heal.
Exactly. It could be such a powerful testament to the idea that even in the face of, some pretty serious environmental damage, hope is not lost. That we do have the power to change things for the better, especially when we work together.
It's about collective action, right? It's about recognizing that we're all in this together, connected to each other and to the environment.
Absolutely. And a museum like that, it wouldn't just be about the past either. It could also be a hub for ongoing dialogue, a place for the community to learn from what happened, talk about the challenges that remain, and work together to create a more sustainable future for the Olona.
I love that idea. And honestly, I think that's a great note to wrap up this deep dive on. We've covered a lot of ground, haven't we? From those bustling mills and clever farmers to the really tough realities of pollution and this inspiring journey of recovery that the Olona is still on. It's a story that really gets to the heart of that complex, ever-evolving relationship we have with the environment, doesn't it?
It really does. And it's a story that I think resonates far beyond the banks of this one river in Italy. Because ultimately, the Olona's journey, it reminds us that we have the power to shape the fate of our waterways, but it takes more than just awareness. It takes action. It takes a commitment to finding solutions, to working together, and to never losing sight of that essential connection we have to the rivers and all the natural systems that sustain us.
It's a call to action for all of us, isn't it? So, to everyone listening, as you continue exploring these sources and learning more about the Olona, I want you to think about the waterways in your own lives. What are their stories? And what can we learn from the Olona's journey, both the mistakes and the triumphs, that we can apply to ensure a healthier, more vibrant future for the rivers that we all depend on?
It's a question worth asking ourselves, because ultimately our connection to water is a reflection of our connection to each other and to the planet we call home.